We are highlighting an amazing working woman today. A dope one who know a lot about the head wraps and the scarves and the struggle sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, when it falls off and when it don't stay on, you know, because you a wild woman. You sleep crazy and you end up with a certain result.
That scarf came off last night.
It came off
that jank. Gotta get the bobby pins.
For me. Oh, okay.
Look at that fan
too.
Back there.
You see me too, though. I can't even get mine all up in there.
You good, though. It's neat. It's cute.
I like yours, too.
Nah, you know, we do, got that little five-year-old fan.
See, we do that. We do, like, the head wrap song on the morning show, too.
Oh,
like,
yeah?
Every Tuesday and Wednesday, I do the head wrap song to represent for all the queens with their crowns.
My God.
And we
you
talk
know.
About the ladies with the silk and the satin head wraps, because sometimes it get wild. You sleep yeah, wild, that's you wake
I'm
up,
saying.
And your head wrap be under the fitted sheet. And it's, and that's how you
see
get
what,
the,
I'm saying?
What you call that?
The fan.
The fan.
Shout out to Rapsody in the building, man. She said when because she got the bun up.
Right.
But it's like the little bit of leave out in the back of that thing. Like when, like,
the little leave out,
like when all the hair don't get in the bun.
Oh.
And she said you call that the fan.
The fan.
When it's
okay.
Hanging out the back like that.
Okay.
She got the fan.
Is that what it looks
so
like?
So shout out to all my ladies with the fan this morning.
Okay.
It couldn't all get up in the bun, but we gonna rap with Rapsody. We gonna head rap with Rapsody.
That's right. She is our Working Woman Wednesday salute.
There shout out to my hustlers.
Of course, you the ultimate working woman. We got Rapsody in here right now. I can't just call her a rapper. You know, a dope lyricist, musician. Straight out. Where you from originally, Rapsody?
North Carolina. I grew up in a small town called Snow Hill, North Carolina, out east.
Mm.
Yep.
What was it like growing up in Snow Hill?
Man, it's country, man. Like, I went outside, played barefoot, you know, in the woods, in the field. I played a lot of basketball. You know, we ride a lot in the car.
Yeah.
We just ride and joke and listen to music. Like, it was just good. You had a lot of pig pickings. What you know about
pickings.
That? Pig picking is when you get a big-ass grill,
like
a big grill. You put the whole pig on it. Not you don't cut it up. It ain't like you don't get a pork chop. You put the whole pig.
It's a whole pig.
The head, the legs, everything. You cut that thing open. You get the meat out you want. They chop it up.
So I guess the people in Snow Hill, they ain't on no Dr. Sabi diet.
They are not on that Sabi. Let me tell you that. Yes, sir.
They putting the whole pig
ain't
on
not,
that thing.
Not one they planet not smoothie nowhere. Nothing. No raw juice, nothing.
So is that where the Knife Wonder Connect is then?
No. I went to college in Raleigh, North Carolina, NC State University.
Okay.
And there I met some friends. We started a hip-hop organization. We do events, you know, around the campus, shows in the city. And one of them was interning with Knife. And he was like, yo, can you come check out my crew? And that's how I met him. He came. He listened to the first songs I ever did. And you know, that the rest is history with that. I've been rocking with him ever since.
Yeah, I remember I was at a small little town in North Carolina, and I bumped into Knife at this random bar. It was like Knife was in there, and what's my man name? It was like an NBA player, but it was like a random bar, like in the middle of nowhere, and Knife was in there. We was chopping it up and all, and I think this is around the time... the last time you was doing your runs, and I remember you was doing your interview, and you was talking about how he sat you down and he made you listen to certain albums before. What was those albums he made you listen to?
It was 10 of them.
Right, right.
Jay-Z's The Black Album was the one I ran the most.
Mm-hmm.
Midnight Marauders and Low End Theory by Tribe Called Quest. A Doggy Style by Snoop, which I heard these albums, but I had to listen to them in a different way.
Yeah.
I couldn't focus on the lyrics and what they were saying. I had to listen to how they were saying it,
Word.
The performance of it.
And I noticed you got a lot of Jay-Z, you know, references, and a lot of times you give him ups in this new album on Eve, which is, you know, a great body of work.
Thank you.
I've been riding to it, you know, for the past week or so. And of course, like me being biased, like I'm a J. Cole fan, so like me being biased, I go right to the one. I'm like, you know
Sojourner.
What? I'm like, let me just run the whole joint. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I run it from top to bottom, and even like the flow of it from the, you know, the poet. Who is that doing the poetry on there?
This amazing poet from Los Angeles by the name of Raina Biddy.
Okay.
Yeah, she's amazing. I met her through Soundwave, who does a lot of production with Kendrick Lamar and TDE.
Mm-hmm.
And I would follow her on Instagram. I love the posts. She posts like little excerpts of her poetry. And then I followed her on Twitter, and she posted a SoundCloud, and she was doing her poems in audio format, and I heard her voice, and that's when I was like, I gotta have her, because I started in poetry before I started rapping, but I needed her to balance out the album. Like, I'm super lyrical, storytelling, but I wanted somebody that could speak to it from a poetic side that just was straightforward with the message I was trying to tell and just bring that balance.
And so how did that work with as far as putting her on the records? Like, did you finish the entire song first and then say, hey, hop on the end of this? Because some songs she's on the beginning, she's on the middle, some songs she's at the end of it. Mm-hmm. Like, how did she sit in the studio with you the whole time?
Was in L.A. I was in North Carolina. Okay. We did, like, a lot of texting back and forth. I would have the songs done, and once, you know, I had like a pretty solid sequence.
Yeah.
You know, we had some songs change. I knew I wanted her on the intro, and I knew I wanted her on the outro.
Right.
So I sent her those. I'd be like, write about this topic, or write about, you know, black women being there for black men, but not always feeling appreciated and loved. Mm-hmm. That's a Feeny. Or, you know, then once I had the most of the sequence, you know, I was like, I need her this spot, I want to hear again here. Mm. And she just filled in the blanks, you know. So.
And this is how I know this is a good album, because I found myself talking back to you, like, on a Feeny, like, when you, you know, when you reference, like, Common and stuff like that. And I'm like, hold on, like, as a black man who uplift Queens, I'm like, hold on, now we ain't all like that. And then you come back with another record where, you know what I'm saying, you're not exactly, it's not like one angle.
No,
album,
never.
You know
one
what I'm
angle.
Saying? And, that, yeah. And as I'm listening to it, I'm like, all right, she pulling in my emotions a couple different ways, and that's how you know it's a good body of work. So if you haven't heard the album, each track on the album is titled after a powerful black woman, in some way, form, or fashion. And did that come before or after you doing the records? Like, did you know, all right, I'm gonna call this Tyra, I'm gonna make this song about this?
You talking about doing the creative process?
Yeah.
That came in different ways. Like, some mornings I wake up and I knew, like, I need a song that I want to title Felicia, because I want to talk about motherly love. Like, she represents motherhood for me. Or I'd be like, I have to have Maya, because I started in poetry. I want to talk about the poetic side. And The Caged Bird Sings is one of my favorite. I know why The Caged Bird Sings is one of my favorite Maya Angelou poems, and what that meant to me. So I was like, I know what I'm going to write about. And then some days you just get up and you write, and it's like, yo, I feel like this today. And there's always a black woman that you'll find that represents that emotion or that story you're trying to tell. So that's kind of how I went about it. You know, it was different, but, you know, it was easy at the same time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And one thing I really like about you, and I could tell that by listening to the album, is like, you really rap. It's really important to you that you rap facts. You know what I'm saying? As far as, like,
I'm a Jay-Z fan.
Yeah.
Coming from that Jay-Z family tree, you got to.
It's like, hey, I believe you got that Audi. You know what I'm saying?
Like, I do. If I didn't, I would not rap about it.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like, I'm listening to it, and I just appreciate it. Great, great features on here in a wide scale. I mean, you got Jid from Dreamville on here. You got J. Cole. You got PJ Morton, who's dope as hell. You got L. Vaughn on here, and your verse that you did on her project
Wishing Well.
Man, listen, that verse right there, when you say X's resemble crosses, those can bury me. Like, that, man. Like,
thank you.
And I want to ask you, because I'm listening to it, I'm like, and me, you, as an artist myself, I find that sometimes it's a little, I don't want to say easier, but the approach is different as when you're doing features as opposed to doing your own record.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that the same way, or do you?
Nah, I approach them all. I mean, you have more control of your own joint, but for the most part, I don't do a feature unless I feel the music. Mm. Like, it's got to feel right. That's one thing I learned. Like, before anything somebody sent me, I'd be like, all right, I get on it. But I had to learn that you gotta do what speaks to you. Because I know when I send out music for people to get on, I don't want them to just get on it. I want them to really feel the record. If they ain't feeling it, then just let me know. It ain't no feelings or emotion, because the music is the biggest ego in the room. So, you know, if I'm feeling the record and it's nothing, like, it's, I treat it like my own. You know?
So with you being somebody who's been doing it for a minute and is true to it, how important is it to you to, I guess, appeal to this younger wave? Like, is that important to you? Like, do you feel like you have to? Not at all.
I feel like when you do that, then you kind of lose yourself, and now you're forcing something. Like, you just got to do what feels right at the end of the day and be yourself. And that should shine through no matter what generation you come through, just making dope music. If anything, like, you know, I experiment with the sounds that I rap over, but that's for me, because I want to always challenge myself and grow, but never grow outside of my lane. I know my lane, I know it's wide, but I don't want to go outside that. Like, Travis Scott has his lane.
Right.
Run your lane. You know, Kendrick has his lane. Run your lane. I know what my lane is. So, mm-hmm. you know, I just try to fill it and grow within that for me. So, you like on this record, most people are like, you know, there's trappy sounding beats, but they trappy for me. You know what I'm saying? Like, right, it might not right. be a trap beat Young Thug would get on, but right. it's a Rapsody trap beat.
Right.
So in that, it's like, right, you can experiment right. and grow, but it's not outside of you and who you are and what feels right in your brand. So that's what I stick to. As long as that joint feel right and it's dope, then I'm going to rock with it. But I don't chase trends. I don't try to chase, like, appealing to a certain demographic, because Knife told me something one day. He was like, you can spend your time trying to... trying to reach and get the same 10 million people that everybody else trying to get, mm-hmm. or you can be content with your 300,000 fans and know that it's you got them forever, you know, because other than that, I'm always going to be chasing trends. I'm always going to be having to keep up, and you burn out, and then it doesn't become fun, and you don't love it, and it doesn't become happy. It's not happiness to you. So you just got to always do what feels right to you at the end of the day.
And what you find is that them 10 million people are shifty.
Very
you
shifty.
You know, it go, they follow whatever is in that, you know, right. you follow Jay-Z, so whatever is in that white hot space.
That's what they
as
on.
As opposed to you, your 300,000 going to ride with whatever.
Forever
whatever.
And a day. Yeah. That's, when you look at Tribe and all these, Jay, like, they keep the same fans. And yeah. That's going to feed you and keep you around for 25 years.
So, of course, like, what? And I want to think of a different way to ask you this. So for Working Women Wednesday, and I know you've seen all the uproar with, you know, JD coming out saying it should be something called strap for stripper rap, and, you Jesus. Know. And it's like, where do you, as a true lyricist, okay, how do you kind of balance between, yeah, I am really talking what other women ain't talking, but still not sounding like, I guess, like a hater or like you bashing those who aren't necessarily lyricists. Like, where do you kind of lie in that, you know, in that conversation of, well, the women who popping ain't really talking about nothing, but because I heard in your lyrics sometimes you say, hey, they don't want to put you on unless you're showing ass and titties and stuff like that. Like, mm-hmm. so where do you lie in that conversation?
Oh, it's I respect all the artists. It ain't the artist's fault. They telling their stories and their truth. Mm. And, you know, I think it's dope. Like, I think we need all variety and sounds and styles. I know who gets pushed to the forefront, and I know why, but it ain't the artist that does that. Mm. You know, it's a lot of times within the music industry and people that don't look like us, and they want a certain image always portrayed. So, you know, my thing is just to do my part to bring balance, you know, but at the same time to uplift and respect my sisters that's doing it too, because, mm-hmm. you know, at the end of the day, like, people have different lanes of vibes that they feel. Like, I love Cardi B. I like Megan Thee Stallion. I think she dope. She gave me that energy of when I first heard Trina. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And you mm-hmm. need that. Everybody don't want to listen to Rapsody every day. Right. Everybody don't want to listen to Cardi every day. Like, you need something for everybody, yeah. and every different vibe. So I think the what women doing now in hip hop is dope.
Yeah.
You know, but we as people have to understand our power. Like, you know, I've said this in all the interviews, like, instead of Jermaine could have took that opportunity to put other women on that he likes. Like, mm-hmm. if you don't like it, don't talk about it. You mm-hmm. know, it ain't for you. So that's what it's all about for me. Understanding what we as a people have power. Like, if there's something that you don't like, then go find what you don't like and what you do like and support it.
Yeah, instead of taking that, like, platform to talk
I've
about
I've seen
you,
so
yeah.
many think pieces on this female rapper and that female rapper that you don't like. Why don't you write a think piece on somebody that you do that like you do and like. Put somebody else on? Like, otherwise, it's the same thing like the Trump model. Mm-hmm. Trump says whatever he says because he knows it's going to turn into clickbait. And at the end of the day, you know how they say, like, no press is bad press.
Right.
So it's the same theory. Like, just talk about what you do like and the people that you do like. But at the end of the day, you can't be mad at the artist. Mm-hmm. They creating their art how they want to create their art. Yeah. So if it go, it just go. Like, I can't be mad at them.
Yeah, and I always say you can never assume somebody is doing what you're doing for the same reasons.
No, like, you know some people are, they that's what I say, like, if you in music, you have to define what you want out of it before mm-hmm. you do anything. What kind of artist do you want to be? Do you want to just come in and get it and be out in 2 years, or you want to have a legacy? Like, and that'll define what road you take and what path. So mm-hmm. you know, just we understanding the difference, like, that's the biggest thing.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, that's what it is, man. We got Rapsody in here right now. The album Eve is out. If you had to say who this album is for, who would you say this album is for? What was your direction?
it's for black women first and foremost, but at the same time, it's for everybody.
Right.
It's my letter to black women, but it's also a letter from all black women to the world. Yeah. It's something black men can relate to. Every black man is raised by a strong black woman, I think, or they know a strong black woman. I've had a lot of people of the different races that even gravitate and pull something to it, which I thought was dope.
Yeah. Like,
it's for everybody, you know, to learn who we are and see us and maybe even see themselves, you know, or be inspired, you know. It's for everybody.
I mean, we the number one culture that inspire everything.
Man, we drive everything. Yeah, but yeah. I mean, first and foremost, I made this for black women.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's what it is. Speaking of black women, of course, the latest visual you dropped, Oprah, is also directed by a black woman, right?
Creative director is Misa Hilton, who's a black woman. And the director who shot it and helped us, you know, with all the bringing it to life on a camera and is our Farrah X, and she's from the Middle East.
Oh, okay.
But she owns a production company that's all women.
Yeah.
All women, and I thought that was dope. But yeah, creative director is the legendary Misa Hilton.
Well, I mean, of course, shout out to all the working women. Do you got any working women that have a lot to do with what you do that you want to shout out? Maybe stylists, maybe hair, maybe, you know, your director. Go ahead and put on for some more working women.
My circle of working women, I'm going to start with Misa Hilton, who's not only a stylist, but, you know, somebody I enjoy creating with. Yeah. Creative director, Tia Watlington, who's a production manager at Jam Records. Let me see. We got Darren Gilliam, who's from Annapolis, Maryland.
Okay.
She owns about 3 or 4 businesses. You know, she's a mom. Like, she does. I don't know how sis do it. Darren, you a G.
Yeah.
Sherry Bryant, who's one of two new presidents at Roc Nation. You know, she started at Rockefeller when she was 16, and now she's running Roc Nation, which is dope.
Yeah.
Man, I could go on and on. Erica Brooks, who's a stylist. Shanae, Bianca Edwards, you know, these are marketing people at Roc Nation. Like, I'm just surrounded by a bunch of...
These are the girls you were naming with the big butts on
Nah. Okay. But they working women, too. They working. Shout out to my sister, Kenyatta, with the big old butt. She's a CPA. Shout out to Katanya with the big old butt. She's an entrepreneur. She got a nail shop. Shout out to Amanda with the big old butt.
Yeah, you know? Shout out to all the queens with the big old butts.
Big old butts.
Make sure y'all go download, stream the Eve right now from Rapsody. Go check out the visuals, Instagram, all the social media, how they catch you.
Across social medias, follow me at Rapsody, Rapsody. Don't put no H in my name.
Don't
please,
do
please, with
Don't
all due
that.
Respect. You can go to my website, iamrapsody.com. You can watch videos. You can download and stream the album. You can get tickets to the tour with me and Big Crit. I'll be on starting October 16th across the nation. You can get merch. We got some fly E jackets, some t-shirts, whatever you want or need. You could follow me on my socials from the website too.
So. That's what it is. And shout out to everybody in North Carolina over there. What it's called?
Snow Hill 252 Pig Picking.
Pig Picking, baby. We doing this. Working Woman Wednesday, the morning hustle with Rapsody. Know that.